New observations administered by NASA's Juno spacecraft have pointed to the discovery that Jupiter's Great Red Spot is far more profound than conceived. The conclusions reveal that the storm extends 300 miles down into the giant planet's atmosphere. This suggests that the Great Red Spot, which is the solar system's most enormous storm, is broad and deep enough to consume Earth from sea level out to the position of the space station, at the height of around 240 miles. Because of its enormous width of over 10,000 miles, and the fact that the gas giant's atmosphere reaches its center, the crew behind the findings still defines the storm as flat as a pancake. It lords over our solar system, a megaworld, 2.5 times the mass of all the other planets combined. This spinning Titan whips up dangerous radiation and fierce hurricanes and dangerous magnetic fields. Jupiter is a behemoth, but this classification does not do it justice. For one, the mass of Jupiter is 320 times as massive as the Earth, and Jupiter is 2.6 times more massive than all the other planets in the solar system merged. Here is the captivating thing. Additional mass would make the planet denser, which would cause it to pull in on itself. Physicists expect Jupiter could end up with 4 times its current mass and remain about the same size. Although astronomers have previously called it a failed star, it is not an apt description. While, like a star, Jupiter is enriched with hydrogen and helium, Jupiter does not have enough mass to ignite a fusion reaction in its core. Stars produce energy by fusing hydrogen atoms under excessive heat and pressure to create helium, releasing light and heat. This is made probable by the enormous gravity. For Jupiter to ignite a nuclear fusion scenario and become a star, it would need over 75 times its current mass. If you could crash dozens of Jupiters collectively, you might make a brand new star. However, Jupiter shall remain a large gas giant, with no expectations of becoming a star ever. Jupiter is by far the most active spinning planet in the solar system. For all its size and mass, Jupiter sure moves swiftly. With a rotational speed of 12.7 kilometers per second, or 7.5 miles per second, or 45,200 kilometers per hour, 28,200 miles per hour, the planet only needs about 10 hours to complete a full rotation on its axis. Because it is spinning so rapidly, the planet has smoothed out at the poles a bit and is swelling at its equator. Points on Jupiter's equator are over 4,600 kilometers further from the center than the poles. This highly accelerated rotation also helps produce Jupiter's powerful magnetic fields and contributes to the dangerous radiation enclosing it. The storm clouds on Jupiter are relatively thin. All those beautiful swirling clouds and storms you see on Jupiter are about 60 kilometers thick. They are composed of ammonia crystals broken up into 2 separate cloud layers. The darker material is considered compounds brought up from lower inside Jupiter, and they change color when they react with sunlight. Below those clouds, it is just hydrogen and helium, all the way down. The notorious Great Red Spot on Jupiter is one of its most prominent features. This tenacious anticyclonic storm, located south of its equator, measures between 25,000 kilometers in diameter and 13,000 to 15,000 kilometers in height. It is big enough to contain 2 or 3 planets the size of Earth's diameter. Furthermore, the spot has been around for at least 360 years, since it was detected in the 17th century. The Great Red Spot was first catalogued in 1665 by Italian astronomer Giovanni Cassini. By the 20th century, astronomers speculated it was a storm, one which was created by Jupiter's intense and fast-moving atmosphere. These theories were established by the Voyager 1 mission, which observed the giant red spot up close in March 1979 throughout its flyby of the planet. However, it appears to have been shriveling since that time. Based on Cassini's observations, the size was 41,000 kilometers in the 17th century, almost twice as large as it is now. Astrochemists do not know if or when it will ever vanish entirely, but they are relatively sure that another one will appear somewhere else on the planet. Not widely known, Jupiter also has spectacular rings. When people think of ring systems, Saturn naturally comes to mind. However, both Uranus and Jupiter have ring systems of their own. Jupiter's were the third set to be determined, after the other two, because they are very faint. Jupiter's rings contain three segments: an inner torus of particles identified as the halo, a relatively shiny key ring, and an external gossamer ring. These rings are widely considered having come from material ejected by its moons when meteorite impacts strike them. In particular, the key ring is thought to be composed of material from the orbiting moons of Adrastea and Metis, while the satellites of Phoebe and Amalthea are believed to accommodate the two distinct aspects of the dusty gossamer ring. Because of Jupiter's strong gravitational influence, this ring material fell into orbit around Jupiter instead of heading back to their particular moons. The ring is also depleted and refreshed regularly, as some material deviates towards Jupiter while others add new material. Jupiter's magnetic field is a whopping 15 times stronger than Earth's, and astronomers think the magnetic field is formed by the eddy currents, i.e., swirling passages of conducting materials within the liquid metallic hydrogen core. This magnetic field confines sulfur dioxide particles from Io's volcanic eruptions, generating sulfur and oxygen ions. Collectively with hydrogen ions originating from the atmosphere of Jupiter, form a plasma sheet in Jupiter's equatorial plane. The interplay of the magnetosphere with the solar wind produces a bow shock, a formidable belt of radiation that can destroy shuttlecraft. Jupiter's four largest moons all orbit within the magnetosphere, which preserves them from the solar wind and makes the probability of establishing outposts on their surface questionable, though Elon Musk has proposed this scenario. The magnetosphere of Jupiter is also liable for intense episodes of radio emission from the planet's polar regions. Jupiter has 79 moons, and still increasing. As of the penning of this documentary, Jupiter has 79 established and named satellites. However, it is determined that the planet has some 200 natural satellites orbiting it. Almost all of them are less than 10 kilometers in diameter, and were only observed after 1975, when the first spacecraft, Pioneer 10, arrived at Jupiter. It also has four major moons, collectively distinguished as the Galilean moons, after they were discovered by Galileo Galilei. These are, in order of distance from Jupiter, Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. These moons are some of the most significant in the solar system, with Ganymede being the largest, measuring 5,262 kilometers in diameter. Jupiter has been visited 9 times by spacecraft. Jupiter was first visited by NASA's Pioneer 10 spacecraft in December 1973, and then Pioneer 11 in December 1974. Then came the Voyager 1 and 2 flybys, both of which happened in 1979. A long break was supported until Ulysses appeared in February 1992, accompanied by the Galileo space probe in 1995. Then Cassini made a flyby in 2000 on its way to Saturn. Finally, NASA's New Horizons spacecraft made its flyby in 2007. This was the final mission to fly past Jupiter, but it surely will not be the last. The Juno spacecraft charged into the magnetic storms of Jupiter, daring the planet Jupiter to release its secrets. Juno is part of a more significant effort to see into giant Jupiter, to glimpse a moment over 4 billion years ago when planets were born, annihilated, and thrown into space. It was when the future of our own small and fragile world was draped in the balance. The Greeks called this planet Zeus, the Romans called him Jupiter. The king of the gods hid his nefarious activities behind swirling clouds. Only his wife, the goddess Juno, could pierce the veil of mists to catch him in the act, hence the spacecraft's name. NASA's Juno, the Jupiter near-polar orbiter, left Earth on a mission to peer into the mysterious Jovian atmosphere, to find clues to the powerful forces that churn beneath its roiling cloud tops. At some 300,000 times the mass of Earth, Jupiter holds over 70% of the mass of the solar system, beyond the Sun. Juno is the latest in a series of missions designed to measure the properties of the planet. How on Earth did Jupiter get so large? Furthermore, how was the Earth shaped into a rocky blue world? To understand Jupiter's early years, astronomers have been watching another solar system take shape out in the constellation Pictor. 63.4 light-years away, a young star, Beta Pictoris, grows its first crop of planets. One is large enough and far enough from the star to be photographed, Beta Pictoris B. Astronomers have now seen it on both sides of its orbit. Look at Jupiter and you will see a snapshot of our solar system over 4 billion years ago. The observed planet is growing within the outer zone amid clouds of dust and gas ice and countless small objects called planetesimals, with matter swirling into it. The planet is likely a fury of gravitational and magnetic energy. Likewise, its distant cousin Jupiter is surrounded by a raging but invisible maelstrom. The king planet's magnetic field is 20,000 times more potent than Earth. Looking up from Earth, if you could see Jupiter's magnetosphere in the night sky, it would appear more comprehensive than the full moon. Jupiter's zone of magnetic influence is so large that it flares out beyond the orbit of Saturn. Like a lightning bolt that zooms into the outer solar system, Jupiter's magnetic field is the product of a powerful double dynamo. One is down deep and permeates the planet, and the other, close to the surface, rings the equator. When Jupiter's moon Io moves through this magnetic field, it emits powerful bursts of radio energy strong enough to be detected on Earth. Volcanic eruptions on Io send a flood of charged particles into this field, energizing massive auroras that light up the poles on this big world. With a haze of charged particles, researchers around the planet are forming a belt of radiation 1,000 times the lethal dose for humans. Flying by in 1973, Pioneer 10 provided the first hints of this radiation belt when it passed within 130,000 kilometers of Jupiter's cloud tops. A year later, Pioneer 11 took the first close-ups of the Great Red Spot, Jupiter's immense signature storm. The Pioneer findings informed the design of the twin Voyager spacecraft. Launched in 1977, engineers shielded critical Voyager components from radiation. That allows the Voyager craft to capture some 19,000 images, including new views of Jupiter's ghostly rings, the startling icy terrain of its significant moons, Europa and Ganymede, and mighty active volcanoes on its inner moon, Io. The Galileo mission got even closer in 1995. Galileo sent back a treasure trove of discoveries about Jupiter's atmosphere. With a composition nearly identical to the Sun, Jupiter offers a window into the birth of our solar system some 5 billion years ago. Stars and planets are born when clouds of gas and dust contract, often quickened by the explosion of a nearby star. A shockwave from the dying star causes the cloud to collapse and spin. As matter flows into its center, temperatures rise high enough to create a dim protostar. Within the disk, billions of tiny dust particles collide and stick together, forming sand-like grains called controls. Attracted to one another by gravity, furthermore, with static electricity, some joined in forming pebbles. Pebbles become boulders, and finally planetesimals. These kilometer-scale objects can collide, sticking together or breaking apart. The matter continues to flow into the central star. As the star brightens, winds of radiation blow, pushing the remaining dust and gas outdoors. At some distance out, called the ice line, temperatures in the nebula are low enough for water, methane, ammonia, and carbon compounds to form solid crystals. Objects made of rock and ice come together quickly to form protoplanets. By this process, the most considerable growth, the fastest. To withstand Jupiter's punishing radiation, Juno's electronic circuits were encased in a titanium vault. Its components were built of radiation-hardened material. Every part of Juno that can be is wrapped in lead foil. Launched on August 5, 2011, Juno is formally known as the Jupiter Near Polar Explorer. It was the second launch of NASA's New Frontiers program. This series of medium-sized missions expands our knowledge of planetary bodies and delivers new insights into the origins of the solar system. The first mission, called New Horizons, traveled 9.5 years to the outer solar system. It mapped the surfaces of Pluto and its moon, Charon, collected information on their geology, and found clues to their complex and violent history. The third mission, called OSIRIS-REx, was sent out in 2016 to an asteroid called 1011955 Bennu. The idea was actually to land on the asteroid, pick up rocks, and return them to Earth. These samples will help address fundamental questions about the birth of the solar system and the origin of organic molecules that helped spark the evolution of life on Earth. To score crucial new science, these missions have each taken on daunting technical challenges. For Juno, the challenge is to fly close to Jupiter without getting fried by its powerful radiation belts. The spacecraft was sent into a series of highly elliptical orbits to track across Jupiter's poles, then to dive beneath its radiation belts and pass within 4,100 kilometers of Jupiter's cloud tops. Out of each 54-day orbit, Jupiter spends just 2 hours in the zone of maximum danger. The craft spends 3 times each minute, allowing its instruments to capture about 450 slices of data from pole to pole. Besides photographing its complex surface features, Juno is performing a CAT scan of Jupiter. When scientists look at the planet, they see structures like those in Earth's atmosphere, cyclones, jet streams, storms pushing upward. Jupiter and its weather systems are radically different. The planet is much larger, and it also rotates faster and sits much further from the sun's warming radiation. The intricate structures scrolling across the cloud tops are a window to conditions deep inside it. Juno's data shows that Jupiter's surface flows extend as deep as 3,000 kilometers below that magnetic field, slowing down and pulling the planet into a uniform rotation. Scientists suspect the inner zone is a sphere of metallic hydrogen surrounding a solid core of rock and ice. Throughout most of the 20th century, scientists theorized that giant planets like Jupiter form in long orbits, far from their stars. These planets grow by scooping up a rich supply of icy planetesimals. Planets inside the ice line stay small because there is less solid food during their formative years. This general understanding was blown away by recent exoplanet discoveries. The Kepler space missions and ground-based planet hunting systems have identified over 2,000 stars with orbiting worlds. So far, few resemble our solar system. The inner orbits of many star systems are graced with so-called hot Jupiters, large gas giants the size of Jupiter or more prominent, that whip around their parent stars at a close range. Some are being stripped of gas by powerful solar winds. Then there is a class of rocky super-Earths at about twice the mass of our home planet. They occupy the innermost orbits of many other solar systems. It turns out that the most common planets within these inner regions are not rocky at all. It is a class of gas dwarfs, smaller than our Neptune, up to about 10 Earth masses. More minor Earth-sized planets are rare. How did our solar system develop in such a different direction? The answer may lie in Jupiter's turbulent past. As you know, passes in close to the planet, her path bends in response to concentrations of mass beneath its surface. Because Jupiter is not solid, those regions are free to move and shift. Jupiter spins faster than any other planet in the solar system, turning once every 9 hours and 55 minutes. That bulges its equator outwards and flattens its poles. Investigators can detect mass concentrations below the surface by plotting tiny variations in Juno's timing as it orbits. What Jupiter is made of, how its density varies, how forcefully it now spins. Furthermore, how massive or solid is its core? These are all clues about when and how it formed. Our solar system is still buzzing with the remnants of its birth. Wandering rocks have not changed since they formed almost 5 billion years ago. Most are so small that when they encounter Earth, they burn up in the atmosphere. A few larger ones survived the fall. Scientists date these planetary shots by measuring molecular variations called isotopes of two particular metals, tungsten and molybdenum. These meteorites appear to come from two separate populations formed in the inner and outer solar systems. Something must have driven a wedge between these two regions, preventing them from mixing. If this great divider was the young Jupiter, it had to have snowballed. Reaching about 20 times the mass of Earth within the first million years of the Sun's formation, its gas giant neighbors Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune would have formed in its wake. By dividing the solar system, Jupiter would have cut off the flow of matter into the inner solar system, stalling the formation of giant rocky planets or neat piles of Earth. Then came one of the most impactful events in the history of our solar system, one set in motion by Jupiter's sensational rise. The discovery of giant gas planets within the inner regions of other solar systems has prompted a whole new set of questions. Could Jupiter have followed a similar path if these giant planets formed beyond the ice line and then migrated inward? To test this idea, scientists used a supercomputer to reproduce the early evolution of our solar system. They plugged a set of initial conditions into a program designed to simulate the interaction of gas and dust, gravity and energy. The simulation takes us into one cold and dusty corner of the galaxy. 5 billion years ago, shockwaves from a supernova explosion perturbed the cloud, causing it to collapse into a dense central region. Near its center is a vast rotating hurricane of dust, gas, and water. In it, matter flows into a newborn star, along with a thin disk. Flashes of light within the disk represent collisions among larger objects. Concentric rings show their orbits. The large orbit on the periphery is Jupiter, the first full-sized planet to form. From its position, far from the Sun, it has scooped up vast amounts of ice and hydrogen gas within a million years of its birth. Jupiter responds to the gravity of the Sun and the mass of the inner solar system. The model shows Jupiter's inward spiral, known as the Grand Track. As the giant planet's orbit shrinks, it sends the inner solar system into chaos. Jupiter flings most large objects into looping orbits around the outer solar system or streaming into the Sun. Finally, Jupiter feels the pull of another growing planet, Saturn, and retreats to the outer solar system. Jupiter gradually settled back into its current position, leaving some 20 or 30 tiny planetary embryos to patrol the inner solar system. Here, the simulation speeds up to cover the next 50 million years. As these embryos tug on one another, their orbits destabilize. When the dust finally settles, perhaps 100 million years later, the number of planets is down to 5, including Earth and a Mars-sized world there. Everything changed when Earth dared cross paths. A computer model gives us a view of the first 24 hours. It is about a third of Earth away, and its shattered remains in Perth in a shockwave of superheated vaporized rock. A molten ring forms around the planet, subjecting Earth to a rain of secondary impact. Within only a century, this orbiting ring will cool and coalesce into a single orbiting body, the Moon. The complexity of the Moon's formation would have left Earth spinning rapidly on a slightly tilted axis. A day lasted only about 5 hours. Over time, the Moon stabilized the planet's tilt, holding it steady. As it moved out of its current distance from Earth, it gradually slowed our planet's spin. If the grand tax theory explains the evolution of the inner solar system, then it may explain a host of details that have long puzzled scientists. Why, for example, is Mars so small? Jupiter swept up much of the dust that accumulated just inside the ice line, starving Mars. What explains the differences among the various classes of asteroids? The asteroid Bennu, at roughly 500 meters in diameter, appears to be a fossil from when Jupiter sailed toward the Sun. This dark object comprises carbon-rich clay materials. Born in the explosion of dying stars, Bennu itself is a product of collisions. The asteroid has likely been stretched, pulled apart, and reformed in its 4 billion years of travel. Scientists have launched the OSIRIS-REx mission to return a sample to labs on Earth to trace the asteroid's origins. They plan to send another mission, called Lucy, to an ensemble of asteroids, the Trails Jupiter. These so-called Trojan asteroids take their name from soldiers who hid inside the giant horse in Homer's Iliad. The thinking is that Jupiter began pulling them along within the first 1 million years of its history. Then there is the central asteroid belt, a vast hoop of rocks between Mars and Jupiter. As Jupiter moved toward the Sun during the excellent track, scientists believed it dispersed an original ring of rocks and dust. When Jupiter moved back out, it drew a whole new collection of rocks back in. By studying the composition of these asteroids, including a dwarf planet called Ceres, scientists hope to confirm their origin. Finally, the giant planet carries its artifacts from the early solar system. Most of its 79 moons are asteroids or comets captured over the years when they flew too close to the giant planet. The four largest satellites are different. If Io, Europa, Ganymede, or Callisto orbited the Sun, we would call them dwarf planets. Scientists believe these moons formed slowly from a disk of ice and debris that circled Jupiter late in its formation. All four are in tidal lock. Like our own moon, each keeps the same face toward Jupiter. Io, the volcano moon, orbits closest to Jupiter. Io shows what can come from living too close to an unsympathetic god, heaved and stretched by gravitational interactions with Jupiter. Furthermore, warped by tidal resonances with the other three large moons. Io is constantly being turned inside out. With hundreds of volcanoes, some blasting lava to altitudes up to 400 kilometers, Io is the most geologically dynamic body in the solar system. Next is Europa, with its bright, young, glossy surface covered in ice. With a diameter of 5,268 kilometers, Ganymede is the largest moon in the solar system, larger even than Mercury. Then there is Callisto, 2 million kilometers from Jupiter. Spacecraft sensors have shown that these three icy moons, Europa, Callisto, and Ganymede, hold different amounts of water beneath their surfaces. In Jupiter's early years, ice dust and gas flowed into the planet along with a disk. The Grand Track model predicts that Jupiter's disk would have shrunk as the planet moved toward the Sun. The two larger ice moons must have formed before that. Europa formed later and had less water around it to attract. Furthermore, Io had almost none. Jupiter's significant moons did not hoard all the planet's icy bounty. On its inward journey, Jupiter would have carried a wave of ice in its wake, delivering water that might one day have filled Earth's oceans. Once settled back in the outer solar system, Jupiter and Saturn hurled more icy material into the inner solar system. Shards of rock and ice rain down on Mars, Earth, Venus, Mercury, and the Moon. The lunar landscape today bears witness to this period. The 300-million-year fusillade is known as the Late Heavy Bombardment. Scientists estimate that our planet would have been hit by at least four objects 5,000 kilometers across, based on data from the Moon. Each can turn Earth's entire surface into molten lava. These collisions may have unleashed a process critical to the emergence of life, called impact erosion. The effects blasted hot radioactive metals like uranium and potassium off the planet. That allowed the planet to cool rapidly and water to remain. Scientists believe Earth was a water planet in its early years. Zipping along at 200,000 kilometers per hour, the Juno spacecraft takes 2 hours to pass from pole to pole. In that time, it records a variety of readings of a world that remains a gargantuan work in progress. Winds up to 650 kilometers per hour with cold clouds of methane, hydrogen sulfide, water, and other compounds into endlessly swirling works of art. Sometimes white clouds of ammonia snow fly over the wide southern red band, making it seem to disappear for months point of view. It is cold in the clouds, about minus 125 degrees Celsius. Deep within the atmosphere, showers of compressed carbon may fall between the layers in a diamond rain. White spots mark the crests of enormous waves rising and falling along the surface. Twirling storms explode into the upper atmosphere, propelled by heating hundreds of kilometers below. They unleash lightning bolts far more substantial than any seen on Earth. It is the polar regions photographed for the first time by Juno that has defied expectations. Here, the belts and zones of the middle latitudes disappear, and an ensemble of hurricanes dominates the atmosphere. Juno's infrared imaging instrument captured these structures in three dimensions during its fourth pass over the planet. The northern pole hosts a giant cyclone surrounded by eight smaller ones, each over 4,000 kilometers wide. The bright yellow colors show deeper, warmer areas. The darker red colors are more excellent cloud tops. They likely arise from the interaction of smooth horizontal flows in low latitudes and turbulence of the poles. The spin of the planet causes them to drift poleward. This raw sequence gives a sense of their spinning movements. Five cyclones surround the southern cyclone. From an Earth perspective, even these smaller ones are vast, up to 7,000 kilometers in diameter, or about the width of Mars. Why these structures persist without merging is not known. If there is a single feature on Jupiter that has held us in its thrall, it is the Great Red Spot. Juno has been flying directly over it at an altitude of 9,000 kilometers, close enough to see fine details. Historical records show that this vast, high-pressure zone is at least 350 years old. Astronomers have measured it since 1830. But about 16,500 kilometers across, it is 10 times larger than Earth's largest typhoons. Juno's data suggests the Great Red Spot heats the planet's upper atmosphere. The significant cyclone rotates counterclockwise once every 6 Earth days. That period has been getting shorter as the storm tightens. The color sometimes fades for years, then intensifies. No one knows why. It was the bright light of Jupiter that attracted Galileo Galilei in January of 1610. His small telescope was powerful enough to resolve the four large moons circling the Great Hall. If another world could have satellites, he reasoned it seemed possible that Earth could be a satellite of the Sun. If only we could go back in time to show Galileo close-ups of Jupiter captured by Juno. How amazed he would be to learn that such a giant planet, a common in solar systems throughout the galaxy billions of years ago, in-plundered through our early solar system, destroying worlds and setting the stage for new ones. What would he say of our news that Jupiter left in its wake a quiet zone, where a world with oceans on its surface would form? Moreover, give rise to life.
Papa na, Lana, Jemma, Marina.